بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. سورة نون, as we said before, is سورة revealed in Mecca. وسورة القلم, سورة القلم, السورة مكية, revealed in Mecca and has 52 verses. The surah speaks about the Quran, and like other surahs that, as I said many times, that begins with the what they call them حروف المقطعات, which is the letters in the beginning of the surah. As you see in the Surah Al-Baqarah, Alif Lam Mim, Surah Yasin, Yasin, in Surah Taha, Taha, in Surah Maryam, Kaf, Ha, Ya, Ayn, Sa'd, and so on and so forth. And ulama and scholars, they say that Allah knows the best of the beginning of the surahs that begins with letters. Allah knows the meaning of that. Some people says Noon is the name of the bottle where you put the ink. You use the pen, because they used to have the pen been dipped into the bottle of ink and then write down what they want to write. But as I said before, Allah knows why those letters be mentioned. Some scholars try to explain them to say every time Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the beginning those letters, immediately after that he will mention the Quran, which is an indicator that the Quran is the word of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and it is revealed, was revealed in Arabic, and the Arabs couldn't produce anything like it. Although Allah have named the letters of Arabic language in the beginning of it. But in this ayah here, you see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Noon wal qalam wa ma yasturun. The mention of the pen in the Quran, it is not the first time Allah mentioned the pen. He mentioned it in the beginning of the revelation when he revealed Surah Al-Alaq. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ ربك الأكرم الذي علم بالقلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. فالله سبحانه وتعالى when he said read in the name of thy Lord, the most generous, the one who created, الذي خلق, خلق الإنسان من علق, created man from the hanging the clot of blood in the womb. اقرأ ربك الأكرم, read the name of the Lord, the most generous. الذي علم بالقلم, the one who taught by pen, علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. For this is the mentioning of the قلم, the pen, in the early revelation to show the connection between recitation and writing. And Islam is a religion of knowledge, not a religion of ignorance. It is inviting people to seek knowledge. It is not a blind faith. It is a religion that make a person explore the world and the universe and read the divine revelation in his verses in the Quran, and read the divine signs of Allah in the universe, and connect both the verses of the Quran, the signs of Allah in the Quran, the sign of Allah in the universe, and make the connection between both to understand the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or to attempt to understand the greatness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَالْقَلَمِ وَمَا يَسْطُرُونَ. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned the ability of writing. As he mentioned the ability of speech, ability to speak, ability to read, ability to recite, and ability to write. He says in Surah Al-Rahman, for example, أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الرحمن علم القرآن خلق الإنسان علمه البيان. He taught him the art of speech, able to speak, علمه البيان. Then he explained the other form of education or learning, which is writing, documenting, writing books, transforming knowledge through writing. And here it says, والقلم ما يسطرون. And there it says, علم القلم علم الإنسان ما لم يعلم. Then he mentioned the recitation, or the reading. Could be reading from the book or reading from the memory. But he used two words for it. One, he used the word اقرأ, which he said, اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق, which is, implies or encompass the reading and reciting. But he mentioned reading by itself when he says, وما كنت تتلو قبله من كتاب. وَلَا تَخُطُّهُ بِيَمِينَ كِدَ الْأَرْتَابَ الْمُبْطِلُونَ. He mentioned tilawa as reading the book. Tilawa as reading from the book. And qira'a, recitation, not necessarily reading from the book, but also could be reading from the memory. And that's why it is important that to connect the ability of writing and reading, ability of reciting, an ability of documenting with the Renaissance. Because when Iqra was revealed, that's at the beginning of the Renaissance that you have seen today in the world. مَا أَنْتْ وَمَا يَسْطُرُونَ. And سَطَرَ or سَطَّرَ in Arabic is to write down things. Okay? And actually the line of writing is called سَطَر. Okay? سَطَّرَ, that means wrote, you know, in a way that is very specific, very clear. مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. Allah swear by the noon and by the qalam. That Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is not a man that lost his sanity. يعني مَا أَنْتَ مُحَمَّدْ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. Because the Mushrikeen of Mecca claim that Rasulullah ﷺ lost his sanity. He doesn't, you know, is not capable or able to differentiate between right and wrong, and they say he's crazy, he lost his sanity. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one who defended him, subhanallah. مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. You can imagine the comfort happened to Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Hearing Allah Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala saying, don't worry about what they say. مَا أَنْتَ بِنِعْمَةِ رَبِّكَ بِمَجْنُونَ. But this is not a response to him only sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but a response to also the Meccan. That Allah Almighty revealed in the Quran until the day of judgment, defending his Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that's why I said before that Allah praises Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in many ways. He praised his tongue. So no mind to Quran al-Hawa, he never speak but nothing but the truth. He praised his ear. He said Udhunu Khair. He praised his eyes. Mazaq al Basar wa Mataga. His eyes not wander around, his focus, and he saw what he saw. He praised his heart. Ma kadab al fuadu mara. He praised his mind. Ma sahibukum bi majnun. And then he praised him in this surah. He said, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. As a whole, Allah praised him, said you had the best moral conduct. Therefore, there's no human being like Rasul sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in the level that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala praised him. وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. A person goes through a difficult time in their life. If somebody call somebody name, or somebody hurt somebody, took somebody money, did that person have lost something or not? Person have lost something or he did not? Material wise. Somebody took somebody money, somebody called somebody name, their happiness become less because somebody calling their name. Their money being taken from them, physically being hurt. The dunya diminish, but the reward of Allah never diminish. Dunya become less, but the abundance of Allah, the reward never become less, it increase. That's why Allah says, وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. We will give you a reward that there's no diminishing of it. From what they've been saying about you, your patience being rewarded, you know, and appreciate greatly. If Allah said, وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ, you will have a reward, وَإِنَّ لَكَ, very surely you will have a reward that nothing diminishing it, nothing, you know, affected. You will not become less. Allah give you the maximum reward. وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. Because the word mamnoon in Arabic means manqus. And manqus means deficient or less or is not complete. For Allah said, غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ, that means it's not deficient, it is not less, it's a complete reward Allah will give you. إِنَّمَا أَفَى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرًا بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ. Allah will give those people who are patient a reward, that abundance of reward. That's why even Imam Ahmad ibn Hanbal, rahimahullah, when he was suffering, the people tortured him. They asked him, said, why don't you make dua against the people who are torturing you? He said that I'm not making dua against them because I want to have a complete sabr. Man da'a ala zalimihi laysa bisabir. You hear that? He said, even the dua, he don't want to make the dua against them because he want to have a sabr. Why? Because he was worried at the time you make a dua against the leaders who are torturing him, that something would happen, a Muslim being attacked. Before he says, that's how, but a person can make, a person being wronged can make dua. تقي دعوة المظلوم ليس بينها وبين الله حجاب. Be careful of the supplication of a person being wronged. There is no veil between it and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said here, وَإِنَّ لَكَ لَأَجْرًا غَيْرَ مَمْنُونَ. Then he says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. I remember I spoke about this verse some other time, but I'm just reviewing the surah because 2 weeks ago or 3 weeks ago I went back to Surah Al-Mulk for some reason, and then I was told that Dr. Naseemi have finished it. But let me touch on this again. In Arabic language, the expression of inna indicates confirmation and affirmation. See, inna, that means surely, verily, with no doubt. Wa innaka, wa innaka, so the power of it. And verily, surely you. You could have says, and you have khuluq azim. Wa laka khuluqun azim. You could have said, and you have a good moral. No, he said, no. وَإِنَّكَ, very surely you, لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And I remember I shared with you the beauty of tajweed and the power of sound effect, I call it, in reciting Quran. Arab never used to speak every day with tajweed. You don't see somebody doing idgham and gunna, just speaking. This is especially for the Quran. It comes with the words of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because that's the sound effect. Every sound in the Quran, there's an indicator of the meaning itself. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. Therefore you stop, you have your time for the word إِنَّكَ. وَإِنَّكَ, very surely you, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And there's an idhar here of the tanween on the qaf and the letter ayn come after it. And idhar means to pronounce the letter that come after the tanween the way it's supposed to be pronounced. You don't connect the two letters together and join them together as you do in the idgham. Why here is this choice of the harf idhar? Because Allah wants to emphasize in the word azim. His khuluq is mighty, is great. Therefore there's emphasis on this, as if you say, and very surely you have a best moral conduct, best moral conduct. But he says, the greatest moral conduct, the best moral conduct. the mighty, that وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. What is the word خُلُق? The word خُلُق also come from the same roots of خَلَقَ. And the خُلُق means manners, but it encompasses everything a person does in life. From believing in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to conducting themselves in human relationship. Because many times people confuse khuluq with etiquette. A person might have good etiquette but does not have good khuluq. You might have someone, you know, eat in a particular way and, you know, the particular etiquette and so forth, but doesn't believe in God. You have bad khuluq, bad akhlaq, manners, ethics. But you might have good etiquette. A person might open the door for somebody, that's good etiquette. And could be also virtue of khuluq. But if a person say, I don't believe in God, associate someone with God, that person have khuluq problem. Because Rasulullah explained the hadith, he said, Al-birru husn al-khuluq. Al-birr husn al-khuluq. Righteousness is the best moral conduct. Equal, best moral conduct. And birr also like the taqwa. It is the virtue. The best virtue is the best moral conduct. When you know that, then you go to the Quran, see the word, what the word birr being mentioned. In ayah 177, in Surah Al-Baqarah, Allah Almighty says, لَيْسَ الْبِرَّ أَن تُوَلُّوا وُجُوهَكُمْ قِبَلَ الْمَشْرِقِ وَالْمَغْرِبِ وَلَكِنَّ الْبِرَّ مَنْ آمَنَ بِاللَّهِ وَلِيَوْمِ الْآخِرِ. That Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and to the end of the verse, Allah mentioned the fundamental principles of akhlaq. The first one thing in akhlaq is to believe in Allah. Amana billahi. To believe in akhirah. Those two elements, principles of belief, believing in Allah and Day of Judgment, it is are the foundation of all the akhlaq, manners. What I mean by that? Because the best khuluq is when a person act in the honorable manners, regardless of what other people's reaction is. Regardless. And that stems from believing in God, Almighty subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and believing in the reward and day of judgment. Also, the prevention of behavior. The best of it is that when a person believes in the ma'iyyah, in the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala impact their behavior. They don't lie because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala hear them. They don't cheat because they know Allah recording them. They don't abuse somebody because they know Allah can hold them accountable. They do not commit aggression against someone because they know Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will punish them. That the consequences of action, human action, connecting to the unseen, to al-ghayb, make a person, even if there is no human around and there's no somebody enforcing the law, a person still will act and behave in the honorable manners. That's why it says, Man amina al-uquba asa al-adab. Man amina al-uquba asa al-adab. Whoever feels secure from punishment and consequences, that person more likely will have no manners. Will have no manners. Therefore, it begins from feeling the presence of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. No one has felt the presence of Allah more than Rasulullah. That's why his khuluq is the best, because he's so conscious of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to the extent that even when he goes to sleep, his heart stays awake. Subhanallah. My eyes go to sleep, but my heart stays awake. This is amazing. Awakening of the heart. You know, there's some people, we call them the sar'a. You know sar'a? A person was sar'a, when a person have seizures or fall on the ground and he does not become unconscious. There's some people is they're spiritually unconscious, but physically they're conscious. They know what's surrounding, but they don't know what the surrounding mean. And that's why this woman who came to Rasul Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam said, Rasulullah, I do have seizure and I pass out. I want you to ask Allah to cure me. فرسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم said تصبرين ولك الجنة. Would you be patient and Allah will reward you with paradise? He said, yes, ya Rasulullah, I'll become patient because I want Jannah. I will stay with this condition. If being with this condition equal paradise, I'd rather to live with this condition, I'm going to die anyway one day. But ya Rasulullah, ask Allah for me that when I do collapse or fall on the ground, not to be exposed. Look at this woman, who she's not conscious, but she doesn't want to, when she was not conscious, to be exposed. How many women are conscious to expose themselves? For even when she's not conscious, she doesn't want to be exposed. That shows you her conscious really is the heart. She's alert spiritually. That's why at the time she's not mentally awake, she's spiritually awake. That's what she was worried about. She could have said, whatever happened, happened. Allah does not punish me. Rufa al-qalam, pen being lifted and the person not conscious. But she's aware of her condition even if she has not become physically conscious. And therefore the coming, يعني أصحاءهم صرعة. How many people are really well physically, but they're صرعة. They don't think, they're unconscious spiritually. For Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said about the Rasulullah sallam here, وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. And he said, الْبِرُّ حُسْنَ الْخُلُقِ. Said the best khuluq is, birr is the virtue, is best moral conduct. Then Allah says, ليس البر أن تولوا وجوهكم قبل المشرق والمغرب ولكن البر من آمن بالله واليوم الآخر. To believe in Allah and Day of Judgment. And establishing prayer, paying zakah, giving the money to the poor and the needy and kinship, connecting to our kinship, to be patient, صابرين في البأساء والضراء. All of this are virtue. That means the Islamic concept of akhlaq, it does not separate faith from behavior and relationship, doesn't. And that become more clear on the hadith of Rasulullah with the other hadith, where he says that اتَّقِ اللَّهَ حَيْثُمَا كُنْتْ, be conscious of Allah wherever it may be, وَأَتْبِعِ السَّيِّئَةِ الْحَسَنَةِ تَمْحُهَا, and follow the bad deeds with good deeds, so wipe it out, clean the bad deeds, وَخَالِقِ النَّاسَ بِخُلُقٍ حَسَنٍ, and treat people with the best manner. Have just good khuluq, adab, manners, with dealing with people. And therefore, when you examine the life of Rasulullah wasallam, then you come to know the three levels of akhlaq. His relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala was such that he spent a lot of time praying tahajjud at night. And he says, جُعْلَتَ قُرَّةُ عَيْنِي فِي الصَّلَاةِ. My maximum comfort is in prayer. That's why he enjoyed himself. Not sitting in front of a TV all night long until 2 o'clock in the morning. It's not good. LBC, MBC, CCP, all kind of seasons, all kinds of, you know, until 2 o'clock in the morning. It's not good. Not good for your brain too. Seriously, it's not good for your brain. You have to have time off. You can watch news and so forth, but not for 5 hours, 6 hours. It's not good for your brain. Have time for this, time for that. I do watch TV and see the news and so forth, but a person should not spend a lot of time before a TV. Actually, the TV have replaced social interactions. Many people don't talk to each other in the house because the TV is on 24 hours. Am I correct? And TV become between people and their loved one, parents and children, and computer as well, by the way, and husband and wife. For people have to be conscious of that, where you would like to feed this heart. For Rasulullah, his world always alert. His relationship with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the maxim. تنام عيني ولا ينام قلبي يعرض قرة عيني في الصلاة. My comfort in prayer, my heart always awake. And الرسول صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم, his relationship with Allah such that when he was leaving this world, he was given the choice. You want to live a little bit longer or time want to go? Only him was given that choice. And Allah knows that His Prophet will choose to be with Him. فقال صلى الله عليه وسلم بل إلى الرفيق الأعلى بل إلى الرفيق الأعلى بل إلى الرفيق الأعلى. In the company of the Most High, in the company of the Most High, you want to be with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And he gave in a speech few days before he passed away صلى الله عليه وسلم, he said to the companions, there's a servant of Allah was given a choice between the dunya and the akhirah, and he chose the akhirah. He was talking about himself, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. When Umar radiallahu anhu saw the mark on his body from sleeping in a rough mat, and he cried and said, Ya Rasulullah, the king of Persia, the king of Byzantia, they sleep in silk. The mat is made of silk, and he was sleeping on hasir. ينام قيصر وكسرى على الحرير وتنام أنت على الحصير. They sleep on silk and you're sleeping on the rough mat. فهي said صلى الله عليه وسلم, remind me, it was Maghrib time, is it Maghrib time? He says, don't you want us to have the akhirah and have them have the dunya? What does the dunya mean to anyone? وما الدنيا إلا جيفة مستحيلة. دنيا جيفة مستحيلة is impossible, dead animal, the dunya. Or that it change, that the animal that get dissolved on the ground. Now, فالله سبحانه وتعالى says to Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. Your akhlaq, the best. Even his enemy recognizes his akhlaq, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A man wanted to come to take the life of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as all of you know the story. And Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was sleeping, hanging his sword on the tree. The man took the sword and says, Muhammad, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, who gonna protect you today from me? For Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah. Allah will protect me from you. The man lost his balance and dropped the sword. For Rasulullah took the sword and said, who gonna protect you from me? قال حلمك, your forbearing, your kindness. For Rasulullah said, go. He said, Rasulullah put the sword back. He said, would you become Muslim? Because you cannot do like this, the person to become Muslim. He put it, La ikraha fi deen, no compulsion religion. He said, the man said, no, I'm not ready, I'm not going to accept Islam. But I swear by God, I will not fight you, nor I support anyone who fight you. Rasulullah said, go free. Okay, go ahead. The man, as if he doesn't believe it, he looked over his shoulder until he left. And he said to the people, Jidtukum min indi khayri nas. I come from the best of people, humanity. And that's why my beloved brothers and sisters, one of the most difficult aspects of being Muslims is not the most difficult aspect of being Muslim. The best of being Muslims is to control our anger, not to physically hurt somebody, not to have revenge. Many times Shaitan comes to us and says, get back, become even, it's time for you. Even some people get becoming even with their parents. Would you believe that? Person become even with their parents, getting back on their parents. A person at the time have the power to punish, that the time to forgive. Because forbearing al-Halim, من كظم غيظا control their anger, يستطيع إنفاذه. He was able to respond. But he says, no, I will not do that. That's the really the test of every Muslim, is to how much you can practice the real Sunnah of Rasulullah of controlling anger, not to be physically or verbal abusive to others, to think about the best of the other people. That's the khuluq al-azim. That's why when his wife, radiallahu anha Aisha, responded to people who said bad things to Rasulullah, and Rasulullah said, don't respond to them. Because she responded, he said, don't respond to them. Have you ever heard me saying any bad language to anyone? Vulgar language? Did I respond to anyone? Did I curse anyone? I don't. He said, ليس المسلم بالعالين. A Muslim does not curse. ولا فاحش. Does not use vulgar language. ولا بذيء. He doesn't use indecent speech. A person who's really have khuluq, even who tried to convey a curse, he cannot say it. He said, this person has said bad thing, I cannot tell you what it is. It's so bad, I cannot even say it. Because يعففون ألسنتهم, they clean their tongue from any dirt. Because Allah created the tongue for dhikrullah. وقولوا للناس حسنا, say good things to people. Not to curse people. قال علمه البيان, he taught us the art of speech. Not to use it against others. The person should appreciate that. أمسك عليك هذا, control your tongue. لسانك حصانك, your tongue like your horse. If you protect it, it protects you. If you don't, cause you harm. قالوا هل كب الناس على وجوههم أو قال على مناخيرهم في النار إلا حصائد ألسنتهم. What drag people to hellfire other than their tongue? وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. صلى الله عليه وآله وسلم never hit a man or woman in his life. ما ضرب رجل ولا امرأة ولا طفل قط إلا أن يجاهد. Never hit a man or a woman or a child. Never. وإنك لعلى خلق عظيم. His neighbor throw trash at him. When they stop throwing the trash, Rasulullah go and check on them and find them they're sick. How many of us get so upset when we are driving and we're in traffic, or somebody asks us to, can they come in front of us, and say, and then push. I've seen this in Muslim countries. In that Muslim countries, I saw more etiquette. People make sure that no one get in. And they're stuck in the same traffic light. What is this mentality? I don't know. There's no respect for one another and so forth. وَإِنَّكَ لَعَلَىٰ خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ صلى الله عليه وسلم have told us. Is it time of Adhan? I'm hearing Adhan somewhere. Huh? Somebody calling Adhan in their phone. Confusing us. He said, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam was in a journey, and one of the Sahaba, radiallahu alayhim, listen to this story carefully. The Sahabi has cutting his weapons, sword, and other things like that, and plus had the metals and his, camel or horse. But he goes to sleep and have his camel go over the camel of Rasulullah, you know, excuse me. Therefore, he goes and the mother heard Rasulullah scratch his leg. For Rasulullah do like this, walk him up, like, get up. And he realized you're hurting others. The man then goes again and hit Rasulullah. The Rasulullah, you know, did like this to him. Woke him up. This at night. In the morning, Rasulullah asked about him. He was asking, did he ask about me? Did he ask about me? He was worried that to be punished. Because he heard Rasulullah at night. But Rasulullah asked about him, and he came and said, did he ask about me? They say, yeah, he did ask about you. Then he said that, oh no. Rasulullah called him. And he said to him, I called you because I want you to forgive me. Yaqi, listen to this. I challenge myself and you to practice Sunnah. He said, I want to apologize to you, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because I pushed you last night. Did you hear this? He says, I want to apologize to you because I pushed you last night. Sallu ala Rasulullah. اللهم صل على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما صليت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم وبارك على محمد وعلى آل محمد كما باركت على إبراهيم وعلى آل إبراهيم إنك حميد مجيد. جزاك الله خير. السلام عليكم. الله أكبر.